Welcome to episode 6 of our Passage to Eastern Europe vlog with Viking River Cruises. Please subscribe to our channel and select the bell to receive notifications of our new content. Thank you. As with us, some of the passengers disembarked here in Ilok to tour the area, while some took coaches to Osijek, Croatia, 70 kilometers northwest. With the groups disembarked, Viking Vidar continued to Vukovar, Croatia, 35 kilometers north. Our tour's first stop took us to Ilok Municipal Museum on the site of Ilok Castle built in the 15th century. As is always a pleasure, a local ambassador greeted us.
Okay, so did you do any wine tasting? Oh, there's a dog here.
A very playful ambassador indeed, our new friend followed us for much of the trip. The castle was built for the Croatian viceroy and king of Bosnia, Nicholas of Ilok. In 1683, after the castle had been conquered and recaptured over the years, Emperor Leopold I awarded the castle to the Odescalchi family, the local duke of the region. The museum's collection includes over 2,700 different artifacts and cultural displays spread over nearly 1,100 square meters. The museum has been located here at the castle since 1969. Next, we visited a local winery where we toured its cellar and had a very nice wine tasting. During our tour of the cellar, we learned that here, mold is purposely left in the area to assist in maintaining a constant temperature and preventing light degradation. Owing to the difficulty in upkeep, these large barrels are no longer used. The wine tasting was very nice. Of course, we brought some home from the store here at the winery.
It's very popular now, rosé. Yes. A lot of the sales in summer. Now we are summer, right? Yeah. In the US, the climate is very diverse. You have a lot of
sure.
I think Austin, Texas.
No.
Seattle.
Yeah. Very, very.
Seattle doesn't get too hot though.
It's
but that's, and it doesn't stay hot.
On the whole, Northern California probably produces the most wine.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So
north of San Francisco.
Closely followed by New Jersey, obviously.
closely followed by Cape May. We next drove to Vukovar, 35 kilometers north, where our ship was waiting. We headed into town on our own to visit the Vukovar Water Tower, located across the Danube from Serbia. Along the way, there is still visible damage from war with Serbia during the 1990s. What started as a simple water tower when built in 1968 would become a symbol of Croatian unity 23 years later. As Yugoslavia broke apart in the early 1990s, many people wanted an independent Croatia, but were met with opposition by the local Serbian population. When that opposition soon turned violent, the Yugoslav People's Army, directly supported by the nationalist government of Serbia, fought against an independent Croatia and attacked Vukovar in August 1991. During the Battle of Vukovar, the Vukovar Water Tower was a frequent target of the Yugoslav People's Army, and while pummeled by 640 projectiles from across the Danube, mostly remained intact. During the 87-day siege, two very brave Croatians, Hrvoj Zalto and Ivan Ivaninka, took turns every night placing a new undamaged flag atop the tower. Ivan was killed in the battle. Hrvoj lived until 2014. It was a privilege to stand where these brave men fought for democracy.
That's a hole in the side of the brick building. And although it's been turned into a museum and kind of a remembrance center, that's a hole in the brick building. And it's interesting to implicitly trust that this place has been properly reinforced. Of course it has, but imagine the two guys that were just shown in the video. Top where the flagpole is. Imagine what it was like in here during the war at night trying to raise that flag while getting shelled. That's some serious bravery.
We had a bit of a wander through the port area before returning to our ship. The next day, after a brief stop to clear Hungarian customs, we continued to Kalocsa, Hungary. The tour began with a visit to Bakodpuszta horse farm, 23 kilometers north of the port, to see the long-standing tradition of Hungarian horsemen known as Siskos. Due to recent rains, the first part of the performance was on this grassy area next to the entrance road. The performance included unusual maneuvers for a horse, laying down and sitting like a dog, all while the Siskos would rhythmically crack a whip overhead. They are not at any time being hit with these whips. The tradition behind this technique is to simulate gunfire for the horses so that they do not flinch in battle. In the main arena, while the audience stayed seated several rows back in the stands, I was happy to risk a little mud flying about to get close to the action.
Yep, they weren't kidding about the mud.
Several games of skill were demonstrated, but the overwhelming favorite was a little donkey that had his own interpretation of some of the rules.
Come on, little guy. Woohoo!
And we forgot to mention how big the round should be, so here's the first one. And let's see the bus. Now it's full. So here's the winner of the second game. Yay!
Next, we were treated to a concert at the Assumption Cathedral, just 7 kilometers away from the ship. The next morning, we arrived in Budapest. We hope you've enjoyed this episode. Please consider subscribing to our channel and give this video a like. Thank you. In our next episode, and the final one in this series, we explore Budapest. Thank you for watching.